In the future, neurotechnologies will be intertwined with our everyday lives. We are on the verge of revolutionizing the way that humans interact with technology. The benefits of these changes could reshape the course of human evolution. We could change the way we experience the world. All that being said, just how long do we have to wait for brain-computer interfaces to become as common as, say, a smartphone? Hi, I'm Colin Fosnot, and in this video, we're going to talk about medical and non-medical uses for neurotechnology. Despite its potential, it may take some time for neurotechnology to become as ingrained into our society as the touchscreen or the keyboard. After all, this field is still very much in its infancy, and a lot of progress will have to be made before we see any real significant consumer uses. The price of a fully operational, invasive brain-computer interface system is still much too high and provides too little benefit for most people to be interested in having something implanted into their body. Additionally, we cannot accurately and repeatedly accomplish major BCI-related tasks, such as projecting images into our mind with our current technology. We also don't understand the long-term effects that some of these devices may have. Most people would probably prefer to use a BCI that is completely non-invasive. BCIs that are non-invasive do not require that you undergo surgery, and are generally easier to disconnect from. These types of devices, however, also have their drawbacks. It's much more difficult to stimulate a group of brain cells without having a direct line of access to those cells, and the accuracy at which you can stimulate groups of neurons is much lower, non-invasively, than invasively. Despite this obvious limitation, there's been some progress in non-invasively stimulating neurons. In one study conducted at Carnegie Mellon University, researchers were able to project an extremely simple version of the game Tetris directly to the visual centers of the brain when using a device which controls magnetic waves. The most obvious use case for both advancing and using brain-computer interfaces currently is within the medical space. As mentioned previously, there have been incredible strides in improving medical-grade neurotechnology for the benefits of people who require them to communicate and move. For example, robotic prosthetics have advanced dramatically over the last decade, both in fabrication and design, and in our ability to provide neural signals to control them. Communication for people in locked-in states has been revolutionized. New systems of computer control have allowed people who cannot move the ability to once again converse with their loved ones. Improving the quality of life of disabled persons has been and will continue to be the primary goal of many researchers within the field. Scientists are looking to understand the brain and are developing tools such as thought keyboards. Thought keyboards are BCIs which would allow someone to talk just by thinking of a phrase or a word. Inevitably, these sort of advances will likely lead to the development of many consumer applications as well. We may see entire virtual reality control systems emerge from the development of interfaces for disabled persons. It may even be possible to use this technology to advance human cognition or improve the way we interact with everyday technology, such as computers. With these recent advancements, someone like Stephen Hawking could have improved their communication ability exponentially. Imagine how much more he would have been able to accomplish and share with the world if these devices had existed. Medical uses are the most common application for neurotechnology. Early implementations provided doctors with a way of detecting and predicting seizures in epileptic patients. Real-time brain monitoring has provided many patients with relief from frequent seizures and has even allowed for some doctors to preemptively detect that a seizure was likely to occur. This allows for treatment to take place before a seizure, so proper medication can be provided to either alleviate symptoms or prevent the seizure altogether. There are countless other uses for neurotechnology within the medical field, and we'll discuss these further in future lessons. Consumer or non-medical uses for neurotechnology haven't been apparent or feasible until recently. Commonly used brain-computer interfaces struggle with low spatial resolution and poor data quality, which has hindered a lot of innovation within the consumer space. Additionally, it's hard to justify using an invasive brain-computer interface system for something as simple as controlling a video game or improving the quality of sleep. Because of this, Much of the BCI industry, besides a few notables such as Neuralink, has been focused entirely on non-invasive devices. Most consumer brain-computer interfaces have utilized the electroencephalogram, or EEG. EEG is the most easily used brain-computer interface system. However, it isn't without its limitations. In some cases, such as sleep studies, EEG works excellently, provides a decently clear signal of the brain, and very obviously shows broad groups of neurons firing in different areas of the brain. Due to these strengths, many consumer BCIs utilize EEG for tasks such as meditation or focus monitoring. The big question on many neurotechnologists' mind, however, is what else can EEG be used for? Will we ever be able to accomplish tasks such as walking around in a virtual space using an EEG? Will it ever be possible to improve the spatial resolution of EEG? Or is this technology limited, and will we have to develop new non-invasive ways to read brain signals? In this first lesson, we've discussed some of the broad concepts of neurotechnology. We discussed the differences between invasive and non-invasive neurotechnology, and we briefly talked about the different uses that these technologies have. We've also talked about the future and brought up some important ethical questions that need to be considered. Throughout this course, we will continue to learn more about how medical and non-medical BCIs have been used so far and how they can be used in the future. We will discuss how developing BCIs can integrate into existing technology and how this newfound way of integration will improve our relationship with the technology. We'll also discuss how the brain works, exactly what signals these devices are capturing, and dive into the history of neurotechnology.